because they're all smiling. They're smiling because they're clearly amused by this unusual sight of an Englishman in a clerical collar joining them on what's clearly the most dangerous place to be, on top of a moving train. But they're also smiling because, unbeknownst to Charlie, they're rapidly speeding toward the entrance of a tunnel, and he can't see it because he's looking in the opposite direction. Eventually, Charlie realizes the predicament, and he quickly ducks along with all the others as they enter the tunnel. But then, after they come out safely on the other side, the man who had urged him to climb up on top of the train asks Charlie an unexpected question. He asks, "Are you a Christian, sir?" Charlie nods and replies, "Yes, I'm a Christian." Then the man makes a shocking announcement. He says, "I'm Hindu, but I know a Christian, and she drinks blood." Poor Charlie's facial expression changes again, this time to one of horror, and he finds himself completely at a loss for words. And then the man explains, "She drinks the blood of Christ every Sunday." The scene ends with Charlie wiping his brow and breathing a huge sigh of relief. Now, this funny little episode, which may or may not have happened to the real Father Charlie Andrews, clearly shows us how misunderstood Christianity can be among non-Christians. But it also leads us to a broader question that has preoccupied Christians and non-Christians alike throughout the centuries. And that question is, who is Jesus of Nazareth? Is he a false messiah, as Jews believe, or is he merely a great prophet of Allah, second only to Muhammad, as Islam teaches? Is he just a moral teacher, as the Buddhists believe, or is he a reincarnated yogi, as many Hindus believe? Are his claims those of a liar or a lunatic, or is he really the Lord of the universe? You see, throughout the ages, many individuals have tried to answer that question. In the late 1800s, a French socialist claimed that Jesus was a fellow revolutionary. One 20th century advertising executive said that Jesus was the greatest salesman who ever lived. And a musical years ago answered that Jesus was a superstar. Well, in this morning's gospel reading from the Gospel of John, Jesus himself makes it quite clear to his adversaries and to us today exactly who he is. And he does so in a very unusual way. He begins by first asking a question, really two of them. And then he ends by providing what at first sounds like some really odd words concerning his true identity. But as we shall see, these words make up one of the most profound statements in human history. The reading begins with Jesus asking the Pharisees, "Who among you can prove me guilty of sin? And if I am telling the truth, why don't you believe me?" Now it's important that we have some context for what's happening here, for oftentimes scripture has to be understood in chronological sequence in relation to whatever happened right before it. For you see, Jesus had just told the Pharisees that by seeking to kill him, had proved themselves to be children of Satan. And he hammered home his point by telling them, "He that is of God hears God's words, but you hear them not, because you are not of God." Wow, what an indictment. No punches pulled, no meek and gentle Jesus here. Just the cold, hard, in-their-face fact that they were not the saintly men that they claimed to be. Needless to say, they were angered by Jesus' comments, and that brings us to this passage and his question. Who among you can prove me guilty of sin? And if I am telling the truth, why don't you believe? Now we should remember that this isn't the only time that Jesus use questions to challenge people to examine their hearts and decide if they truly were following the kingdom of God. And Jesus was indeed a master of questions. In fact, the four Gospels record more than 100 of them. Of his parents, Jesus asked, "Didn't you know that I must be about my Father's business?" To those who heard him teach but failed to act, he said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say. And of course, there is the question he asked Peter before entering Jerusalem to face his death. Who do you say that I am? But as is clear in today's reading, it's obvious that the Pharisees would stop at nothing to silence this troublesome Nazarene. So they continue their accusations against Jesus by throwing out their own question. Do we not say rightly that you are a Pharisee, a Samaritan, and have a demon? Now, calling someone a Samaritan was about the nastiest comment that you could make in their day. For the Samaritans were the people living in Samaria, north of Jerusalem. And the Jews really looked down on them because they had compromised the purity of their faith and their race by intermarrying with non-Jews and merging elements of their religion into Judaism. But the accusation that Jesus had a demon was far more serious, for it suggested that it was he and not the Pharisees that were being controlled by Satan. But Jesus knew their hearts, and he defended the power of God by working through him by telling the Pharisees, I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Now, these clearly are not the words of a demon-possessed person, for Jesus was telling them that he was seeking nothing less than honor for his Father. And by his words, he was telling the Pharisees that their attacks on him were also an attack on the Father. And yet, the Pharisees were all the more angered, and as John tells us, their bitter accusations against Jesus continued. You see, they were totally blinded by Satan. They were blinded by their pride, by their self-righteousness, and by their sheer hatred of this mere son of a carpenter whose radical teachings were threatening their monopoly on God. In short, their inability to see God's truth betrayed their separation from the Father and his purposes. And Jesus was right when he called them children of Satan. For while Jesus had been given glory by the Father, it was abundantly clear that he would receive none from these people who did not know or listen to him. So after repudiating the Pharisees' accusation that he was self-seeking, and after telling them that it was God's judgment that is true and not theirs, Jesus launches his final attack. He tells them that his promise of eternal life sets him apart from every prophet in Jewish theology, including Abraham. This only serves to infuriate the Pharisees even more, and they reply saying, now we know you're possessed by a demon. Abraham and his prophets are dead. Surely you're not greater than Abraham. Who do you think you are? And that's when Jesus let them have it. He tells them, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Of course, the Pharisees didn't understand, and you can almost imagine them staring at each other with the same look as a deer staring into the headlights of an oncoming car. And they responded, you're not even 50 years old, and you have seen Abraham? And that's when Jesus finally drops the bomb. Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. What a strange thing to say, isn't it? At first, it seems like Jesus' grammar is upside down, and he's mixing the past and the present tenses. But he knew exactly what he was saying. For this was not the first time that Jesus would use the words, I am, in his dealings with those who opposed him. And very likely, you've heard some of them before. I am the bread of life. I am the resurrection and life. I am the light of the world. I am the true vine. I am the good shepherd. I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Each one of these I am statements represents Jesus' willingness to give us what we truly need and not what we want or deserve. In other words, we do need Jesus. For he is the light in the darkness. He is the gate to security. He is the shepherd that guides. And he is the way, the truth, and the life. But it was this one statement, before Abraham was, I am, that really resonated with the Pharisees. And not in a good way. And while this phrase might seem obscure to us today, it was quite familiar to the Pharisees, for they knew exactly what Jesus meant. And so they set out to stone him for blasphemy. But you see, Jesus had just declared his superiority over all the prophets, especially Abraham. And worse still, he was telling them that when Abraham came into being, he was already existing. He wasn't claiming to have been born before Abraham. If that were the case, he would have said, "Before Abraham came to being, I was." That would mean that the Son of God actually came into being at some point. That's not what Jesus said. Instead, by saying, "Before Abraham was, I am," Jesus was clearly telling the Pharisees that he is God, and that his being has no beginning and no end. He was telling them that he is the God of the Old Testament who had spoken directly to Abraham. And most significantly, Jesus was telling the Pharisees that he is the God who, when Moses asked, how do I answer the Israelites when they ask me who had spoken to me out of the burning bush, said, "This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you." So yes, the Pharisees clearly understood Jesus' claim. And as the temple was still under construction and fragments of rocks littered the grounds, they bent down to pick up stones to throw at him. But when they rose up, they could not see Jesus, for he had disappeared from their sight. And as we know, the Pharisees sought all the more to kill Jesus, but his time had not yet come. And this brings us back to the question of the ages. Who is Jesus of Nazareth? Well, he is the reason that Christians gather every Sunday here at St. Francis and at churches around the world. He is the one who has no beginning and no end. He was around before the creation of the world, long before Abraham was born, and who will be around long after our mortal remains have turned to dust. He's the one constant absolute that we have in our ever-changing world, because his character does not depend upon the day of the week or his mood, but on love, mercy, and forgiveness. More importantly, Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promise to send the Savior after the fall of Adam and Eve. And as a result, no matter what darkness we may find ourselves as we travel through this tunnel we call life, Jesus is the one who always stands ready to reach down to us, as the Indian man did to Father Charlie, and beckon, "Come, come. There's plenty of room up here." Thanks be to God. Amen.
We continue with our offering this morning. And our offertory sentence comes from the book of Deuteronomy. "Ye shall not appear before the Lord empty. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord thy God, which he hath given unto thee."